Okay, we're going to start now into another section of Conquest and Judges. We're going to be looking at today and part of tomorrow even. We're going to be looking at Joshua. We're going to be doing a historical study on Joshua and then answer some really tough questions concerning God sending the children of Israel in to destroy the Canaanites. And we're going to look at some evidence of why God does what he pleases, but also in our minds to understand why God commanded that. So give some evidences that God was fully justified in sending them in to destroy the Canaanites. This section on the book of Joshua really is a new section, of course, in the Old Testament. Genesis to Deuteronomy are the books of the law. Now we start into Joshua itself, and Joshua begins a section of what the Bible in the Hebrew canon calls the prophets. The prophets. It's a historical section, but it's also it's recognized as the one of the beginnings of the books of the prophets. In the Hebrew canon, The prophets section is divided into two sections. It's the former prophets and, yes, the latter prophets. The former prophets and the latter prophets. There are several references, is the word I'm looking for. There are several references in the New Testament of Jesus to the Old Testament as the Hebrew canon that it is. So it's the law, the prophets, and the writings. The law, the prophets, and the psalms. The law and the prophets, I think it's usually called the writings. So we have five sections. I typically divide the Old Testament into five sections. You've got some of the historical books. You've got the wisdom literature. You have the major prophets and the minor prophets. Well, in the Jewish Bible, they just divide it three ways. So let me tell you where Joshua fits in with this. The former prophets, of course, Joshua, as I mentioned already, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. Now, the Kings doesn't just mean 1 and 2 Kings. It also includes the other books of the Kings, which is Chronicles. So there's four in our way of dividing it, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. There's actually four books that cover, which is literally a king's chronology. It was an official position in the government of a record keeper, a historian, who wrote down the records, kind of like what we think of as somebody in our business meetings, the secretary or whatever. Keeping track of the minutes of the meetings and keeping track of what happens. And those historical records of the Jews are actually included as God's dealings with man, and so therefore they're inspired of God, even though they don't actually apply to us, even though they're a history of their kings, just like when we went to Chicago to the Oriental Institute. There's records there of Assyrian kings and Babylonian kings and on. But we have the Bible keeping record of the Jewish story. I think that's very significant. The Jewish story is included in the Bible, and therefore it's inspired. So anyway, Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings are the former prophets. And then the latter prophets, of course, are what we call the major and minor prophets. Okay, the former prophets that we're going to focus on here are works recounting the history of the relationship between God and the chosen people from the time of the entrance into the promised land to the separation of the southern kingdom. So we're going to be looking at these former prophets, some of them in this section. We'll go through Joshua, Judges, and the first few chapters of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapters 1 through 8, I believe, that discuss up until the point of the kings. And of course, once we get into the kings section, that's where we pick up with our next semester of the kings of Israel and Judah. Okay, so let's talk about Joshua's preparation first. Joshua's preparation. This is kind of some introductory things, but I just started my own outline here. Joshua's preparation. Does anybody remember where the name of Joshua, as this person Joshua, first comes up? In what story?
Is it a little cow?
No. It's before then. Exodus chapter 17, verse number 8 starts the story. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And it doesn't tell us anything about where, well, later on it says Joshua, the son of Nun, which is, of course, the joke. He had no parents, you know. But he just pops on the scene. Moses said unto Joshua, chapter 17, verse 9, choose us out men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill of God with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua appears for the first time in Exodus chapter 17, verse 9, just appears on the scene. He's obviously already known to Moses, and he also obviously has some type of experience in leading into war. So let's look at some things about his preparation that I think will show us what kind of a person he is. And by the way, let me just emphasize here, Joshua is, he's not on the level of Moses, but Joshua is a great man. Heard this recently, and I know it's true, and I'm sure you've heard this also. What Joshua failed in is that he didn't prepare someone after him. He handed off the country, really, to the tribes in general. And he didn't prepare someone like Moses had done for him. So I've got 10 points here, my first set. And we're just going to go through from Exodus chapter 17 up through Deuteronomy chapter 31. And we're going to see what Moses did. We're going to see all the times where Joshua comes up and see some things about him. So let's look at these events, 10 things that happened in his preparation. So the first thing here, of course, is in chapter 17, verse 9. He's a general of the forces of the Lord. The Amalekites come on the scene, verse 8. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. Obviously, the children of Israel. The Jews don't need any explanation on who the Amalekites are, but we probably do. They were Semites, but non-Jews. These were not Jews. They are not children of Abraham. Am I saying that right? I think so. They were rebels against God. They always were rebels against God, from what we can tell. And I think here in this passage, Joshua recognizes right away that, hey, when it's time to fight against the enemies of the Lord, we got to do something. We got to step up. We got to fight. So after they finished this battle, and of course it was referenced even last night, I believe, in church, but Aaron and Hur held up the arms of Moses as he prayed. And Joshua, verse 13, we see him popping up here again. He discomfited Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Now, verse 14. And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book, and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. Whoa. So here we see Moses is told to write down and rehearse it to Joshua. So Joshua obviously has been picked out. He's been chosen for something. Rehearse it in the ears of Joshua. For I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. Okay, so there's Joshua realizing, I think, something about Amalek, and Moses realizing that Joshua is going to be picked out for a special job. Exodus chapter 24 now. We can go a few chapters without seeing mention of Joshua. Exodus chapter 24, verse 13. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mount of God. Okay, now, verse 13 just says Moses went up into the mount, but we see that Joshua was Moses' minister. Now, what's a minister? Servant. He literally followed him along and helped meet Moses' needs. Now, before you say, I don't need a servant. You know, what did Moses need a servant? Well, we're living in 2017. Moses had the care of 2 million plus people, and he needed somebody to help him with his daily supplies, daily needs. But does Joshua, what does it say? Moses went up into the mount. Look at verse 18. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Okay, so what does this mean? Just Moses went up? That's not true. That's not what happened here. Go back to verse 14. Moses rose up, verse 13, his minister Joshua. Moses went to the mount of God, and he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. Moses went up into the mount. So he goes up to the mount, into the mount. And the glory of the Lord abode on Mount Sinai, verse 16. The cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire on the top of the mountain, the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went up into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. So he went part of the way up, stayed there for 6 days, and on the seventh day, then he went on up into the rest of the way up onto the mount. Now we're going to find in the next passage, Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32. We're going to see that Joshua was also on the mountain with Moses. Exodus chapter 32, verse 17. Okay, to put it into context, in chapter 32, the story of the golden calf takes place. And Aaron, of course, at the bottom, and you know, he had this wonderful, magical miracle take place where he threw in the gold, and it literally popped out a golden calf. Because we believe Aaron. I mean, this is what Aaron said, so we have to believe his story. But anyway, so the Lord tells Moses, here's what is happening down at the bottom of the mountain. So what does Moses do? He goes down from the mount, and all of a sudden, verse 17, you see Joshua is with Moses. Joshua was not down there at that party. Joshua was with Moses on the mount. Now, so put those two things together. Well, let's read verse 13. Verse 17. And when Joshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, he said unto Moses, there is a noise of war in the camp. And he, that's Moses, said, it is not the voice of them that shout for master, neither is it the voice of them that cry for me to come, but the noise of them that sing do I hear. Okay, so Moses knew because God told him. What does that mean? Joshua wasn't with Moses, obviously. So if you put these two into context, in chapter 24, Moses left Joshua part ways up the mountain and went on up into the cloud. Comes back down, most of the way down, gets Joshua, and Joshua doesn't know what's going on, all this noise, and they two head down into the camp. Now, here's that has to be what happened, I believe. And I just think that is an unreal test, an unreal display of Joshua's faith. You know, if you're Moses on top of the mountain, it's pretty easy to stay up there for 40 days and 40 nights, right? You're with God. But if you're Joshua and you're partway up the mount and Moses disappeared into the cloud and he hasn't come back for over a month, you know, something happened to him up there. And all the people at the bottom said, hey, something happened to Moses. Joshua doesn't do that. Joshua has faith. He has patience. He's committed. I think this is a severe test of Joshua's faith that Aaron failed. Everybody understand that? So, very, very important thing I believe here, an important test of faith, and Joshua passes it. All right, let's move on to chapter 33 then. We see another reference to Joshua. Time to get moving here soon. Chapter 33 talks about time to move, time to head to the promised land, build the tabernacle, and go. Chapter 33, verse 11, we see another event. Actually, let me put it into context. Verse 9. Came to pass as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses, and all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose up and worshipped every man in his tent door. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend, and he turned again into the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. All right, Joshua did not leave the tabernacle. Here's the presence of God, and Moses sees fit in Exodus to record this, that Joshua, God saw fit, that Joshua didn't leave the tabernacle. Now, think about whose position this was. Whose job is it to be in the tabernacle? Aaron. You find no mention here of Aaron. It's Joshua and Moses. When Moses leaves, Joshua stays in the tabernacle. I think that's also interesting. It's pretty significant. Let's move on. Numbers chapter 11. So we skip a few. An entire book. Numbers chapter 11 now. All right, the children of Israel were complaining about the food. We're tired of this manna. And so God gave them all the quail that they could eat. Verse 20. All right, go down to verse 24. Numbers chapter 11, verse 24. Moses went out and told the people the words of the Lord and gathered the 70 men of the elders of the people and set them round about the tabernacle. And the Lord came down in a cloud and spake unto him and took of the spirit that was upon him, Moses, and gave it unto the 70 elders. And it came to pass that when the spirit rested upon them, they prophesied and did not cease. Wow. Moses said, man, I'd love to have everybody doing this. You know, just obeying the words of the Lord. But there remained two of the men in the camp. The name of the one was Eldad, and the name of the other, Medad. And the Spirit rested upon them, and they were of them that were written, but went not out unto the tabernacle, and they prophesied in the camp. And there ran a young man and told Moses and said, oh no, these two men, Eldad and Medad, do prophesy in the camp. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of Moses, one of his young men, there he calls him a young man again, answered and said, my Lord Moses, forbid them. And Moses said unto him, Joshua, enviest thou for my sake? Now, that's very telling right there, that phrase. Enviest thou? You're jealous of the fact that they're prophesying because I'm the only one that's supposed to be prophesying? No, no, no. I wish, would God, that all the Lord's people were prophets and the Lord would put his spirit upon them, upon everybody. Now, are you jealous for my authority? So that's what Joshua is doing. Joshua's saying, Lord, this is, Moses, this isn't right. You're the one who's supposed to be prophesying, and they are taking your authority away from you. So, yes, Joshua was wrong, right? He was wrong. Moses corrected him. But he had the right idea that he respected the authority of Moses. You understand that? So, had a great respect for Moses and his authority. I think this here shows that Joshua wasn't a ladder climber. You understand what I mean by that? He's not seeking his own authority. He's not saying, you know, I should be the one prophesying, not these men. No, no, no. He's saying, Moses, you are the one that's supposed to have the authority, not these other people. So there's a concern for the honor of the person that he served and ministered to, not on his own part. That's Numbers chapter 11. Now let's go to Numbers chapter 13. Here's a famous passage, Numbers 13, the spies. We know this story. Okay, so we've got Exodus 17, Exodus 24, Exodus 32, Numbers 11, now Numbers 13. Joshua is sent out with the other 11 to spy out the land. Numbers chapter 13. By the way, I forgot to mention this. Joshua, going all the way back to the first time he's mentioned, he was a general. And he's a general for Israel. How in the world did he learn any experience in that? In Egypt, they were slaves. Joshua learns somewhere something about leading people into battle. Moses, possible, very, very possible. Joshua?
Moses.
Oh, Moses, yes. Did that break? Mm-hmm. yes, Moses, no question. That's one possibility for sure. Anybody else? Yes?
Is it possible that they use some of the slaves to help in whether actually fighting or not, but just being around helping support the Egyptian army?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's actually the most likely. Joshua obviously is... I think there are probably, Moses pointed out a few things, but Moses hasn't had time. I mean, they're only a few months at the most, about 2 months removed from Egypt. And he's had a little busy schedule. You know, he probably hasn't had time to really teach Joshua much. So it's believed that Joshua probably learned how to do this in Egypt. He was definitely already an adult in Egypt, right? And not all the slaves were brick builders. There were probably slaves used for many other things. The most difficult work was brick making. Common people. So, you never read about Joshua's family. You know, he probably didn't have very high self-esteem. You know, he probably blamed a lot of his problems on his past, you know, that he just didn't have parents, you know, that cared for him. Because it never mentions his parents other than that there were none. anyway, Joshua, somehow he learns how to do these things. He's born in Egypt, raised in Egypt, and learned how to lead into battle. And now we really start to see this. Isn't it also interesting? God knew the right kind of person to prepare for the job. Moses was a leader of people. Joshua was a leader into battle from the very beginning. First time he's mentioned, and then going into the promised land. He knew how to pull off ambushes. You know, of course, God helped him, you know, But going up to Hazor, you going up to these other places, many other places, and Joshua is able to sneak out, surprise the enemy, and so on. So, anyway, Numbers chapter 13, Joshua goes with the spies. Look at verse number, chapter 14, now verse number 9. This is when they come back, and I love what Joshua has to say about this. 14 verse 6, go back there. Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, which were of them that searched the land, rent their clothes, and they spake unto all the company of the children of Israel, saying, the land which we passed through to search it is an exceeding good land. If the Lord delight in us, then he will bring us into this land and give it us, a land which floweth with milk and honey. Only rebel not ye against the Lord, neither fear ye the people of the land, for they are bread for us. Their defense is departed from them, and the Lord is with us. Fear them not. Oh, there's several things I see here, but Joshua, he sees that these people are our meat. We're going to eat these guys. But another thing that stands out to me is that he says their defense is departed from them. Joshua knew, as a leader in battle, he knew that once people lose their confidence, once people are afraid, that the battle's over. Their defense is gone. They still have big walls, but they're afraid. Isn't that something? You know, 38 years later, they come back to Jericho, 40 years later. And when they get to Jericho, Joshua sends the spies in. And that time, Rahab says, oh, the whole country's deathly afraid of you. Well, that probably had been the case all along. And all the children of Israel, all the rest of the spies looked at were the big walls and the size of the people. And Joshua knew that the people were afraid. Their defense is departed from them. And the Lord is with us, fear them not. But I think it's interesting. I like Joshua's attitude here. Man, they're our bread. I'm going to eat them for a snack. I'm going to have them. They're mine. They're ours. Numbers 13 and 14. Numbers 26. Numbers 26. Here's the next time we see Joshua. Numbers chapter 26. Look down at verse 63. These are they that were numbered by Moses and Eleazar the priests, who numbered the children of Israel in the plains of Moab by Jordan near Jericho. Okay, so they've gotten all the way around through the 38 and a half years. They're up close to Jericho on the plains of Moab. And Moses, of course, is going to die there. But among these, verse 64, there was not a man of them whom Moses and Aaron the priest numbered when they numbered the children of Israel in the wilderness of Sinai. Nobody was left. They all had died. All the adults were gone. Except Joshua and Caleb. For the Lord had said of them, they shall surely die in the wilderness, verse 65. And there was not left a man of them save Caleb the son of Jephunneh and Joshua the son of Nun. Go to chapter 27 now, verse 15. Moses spake unto the Lord, saying, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation. So, Moses, I think, already knows, yes, God had already told Moses that Joshua was going to take over his position. But now Moses wants, through the choosing of God, wants the people to see that God had chosen Joshua. And you see, we've talked about this before, you know, at the Urim and the Thummim, with finding the will of God, lights in perfection. And so, let the Lord set the man over the congregation, which may go out before them, and which may go in before them, which may lead them out, which may bring them in. That's a term of war. Lead the armies out to battle and bring them back safe. That the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep which have no shepherd. And the Lord said unto Moses, take thee Joshua the son of Nun, a man in whom is a spirit, and lay thine hand upon him, and set him before Eleazar the priest, and before all the congregation, and give him a charge in their sight. And thou shalt put some of thine honor upon him, that all the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient. Verse 22, and Moses did as the Lord commanded him. He took Joshua and set him before Eleazar the priest, before all the congregation, and laid his hands upon him and gave him a charge the Lord commanded by the hand of Moses. So Joshua here is ordained, if you will, hands laid on him. It's a sign of the honor passed on from an older to a younger. It's a sign that he approves of this younger man. And so Joshua is ordained on the plains of Moab, Numbers chapter 26 and 27. Now, He's not taken over yet. That won't happen until Moses dies. But he's chosen out. He's pulled out and recognized. Okay, let's look at a few other passages that talk about Joshua wholly following the Lord. That's a very important aspect of a leader of God's people. Do they wholly follow the Lord? And so we'll see that with Joshua. Numbers chapter 32. Numbers 32, verse 11 and 12. Surely none of the men... Oh, let's see here. This is a recounting of the story, I believe. Yes. Talking about the 12 spies. Surely none of the men that came up out of Egypt from 20 years old and upward shall see the land which I swear unto Abraham and unto Isaac and unto Jacob, because they have not wholly followed me, save Caleb and Joshua, for they have wholly followed the Lord. So we see Joshua followed the Lord. Go to chapter 34, verse 17. 34, verse 17. These are the names of the men which shall divide the land unto you: Eleazar and Joshua. Eleazar, by this time, is the high priest. No, I'm sorry. Not by this. Maybe by this time. I forget when Aaron died in the course of things. But so Eleazar is the high priest. Joshua is the leader. And these two men are going to divide up the tribes unto the children of Israel. Deuteronomy chapter 1, verse 38. Deuteronomy 1, 38. But Joshua the son of Nun, which stands before thee, he shall go in thither, encourage him, for he shall cause Israel to inherit it, the land. So again, we see Joshua and Eleazar are going to split up the land for the tribes. So Joshua was almost ready now to take over and to be the leader. We find that happening in Deuteronomy chapter 31 and chapter 34. So if you would turn there. And this is the passing on of the torch, if you will, from Moses to Joshua. Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 7 and 8. Moses called unto Joshua and said to him in the sight of all Israel, be strong and of a good courage, for thou must go with this people. So Joshua wrote this down, Moses wrote this down, by the way. And Joshua chapter 1, Joshua goes back and reads what Moses wrote down. Remember that passage, Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. The book of the law. Two verses before that. Be strong and of a good courage. He's remembering what Moses wrote. Anyway, so go there in Deuteronomy 31, I was reading, sorry. Be strong and of good courage, for thou must go with this people unto the land which the Lord has sworn to their fathers to give them, and thou shalt cause them to inherit it. And the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee, he will not fail thee, neither forsake thee, fear not, neither be dismayed. So these verses are directly found in Joshua chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, 6 and 7. Okay, one more passage, Deuteronomy 34, verse number 9. Deuteronomy 34, verse 9. And Joshua, this is right after the death of Moses in the preceding verses, and Joshua the son of Nun was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands upon him, and the children of Israel hearkened unto him and did as the Lord commanded Moses. So this is the final mention of Joshua in the Pentateuch. Okay, how old is Joshua by this time? He's at least 60, right? He has to be at least 60. Not has to be. But he was an adult when they left Egypt. He's a leader of an army. That's assuming that he's at least 20 when he's the leader of the army. He's probably much older than that. He's probably close to the age of Caleb. How old is Caleb? I want that mountain. I'm as able now as I was 40 years ago. Close. Keep going. 85. He's 85 years old. Oh, yeah. Huh?
He was 4'4" and something.
Yeah. I'm as strong as I was in the day when I came here as a spy. You know, that's what all 85-year-olds think. It's not necessarily true. I'm not saying he wasn't. I wouldn't challenge Caleb. I'll just back off on that one. All right, so Joshua is now ready, not because man has recognized him, but because God has chosen him and prepared him. So the point is, it took 40 years of preparation. I'm not saying he wouldn't have been ready before this time, but preparation is a huge amount. You know, when we think of Joshua, we think normally of the land of Canaan. So what he accomplished in those years of leading the children while he was in the land of Canaan were founded upon the 40 years of preparation. Moses had 40 years of preparation. On and on. So when God has a big job for you to do, he doesn't just put a little bit into you. He puts a lot of work and preparation and building, and eventually he's got you where he can use you, where you can really be ready for that big job that God has prepared for you. So Joshua and his preparation. Any questions or thoughts on that? Okay, now let me take those. I'm not going to go back and rehash all the verses, but let me now give you lessons that Joshua learned in the preparation. So some of you probably wrote down a couple things that he learned. I want to give you a concise, or a precise, I don't even know what the difference is. Meadow, are you English? What's the difference between precise and concise?
Concise is usually language, like concise, saying something with as few words as possible, straight to the point. Precise is more exactly what is meant. It might take as many words as possible.
Okay. Wow. So concise is shorter.
To the point.
To the point. Precise is accuracy. Okay. Wow. Concise. Let me give you a concise presentation of the lessons that he actually learned. And I say that he learned. These are lessons that jump out from the different times that we looked at in the Pentateuch of his preparation. So some of them are pretty obvious, some of them maybe not so obvious. I have 8 lessons. 8 lessons. And this is the crux of what I want you to know as far as what we've been looking at is preparation. First of all, he learned that God will not tolerate rebellion. God will not tolerate rebellion. Remember, this goes back to the Amalekites. With the Amalekites, God didn't forget how wicked they were, how evil they were. God didn't forget that. This is something that had been brewing for many, many, many years. When you get to 1 Samuel, 350 years after this, Saul was the king, and he was told to go destroy the Amalekites. God doesn't forget. So we think, you know, in our little minds, you know, if God lets me get away with sin for 4 months, maybe he just doesn't care about it this time. No, he cares. You know, he doesn't forget. It's when people rebel, ultimately, eventually, the punishment's going to come. And Joshua, I think, very much learns this. You allow those gods on the other side of the flood to stay in your family? Oh, no. You're going to pay for that. You're not going to be victorious. On and on. God will not tolerate the rebellion of men. Secondly, power is not the power of the sword, but the power of God. When he's fighting the battle against the Amalekites, he learned, as Moses was up on that hill, can you imagine? They're down here in the valley fighting this battle. And Joshua, every time he looks up at the mountain, he sees Moses in there in the distance with his arms raised in prayer. And when they're praying, God gives victory. When they're not, when his arms are down and he's too tired to pray, they're losing the battle. So it doesn't matter, really. The power is not in the sword, it's in the prayer. It's in the power of God. And so this is a very important lesson that Joshua learned. Yes, he needs to be ready to fight Jericho, but really, who's going to destroy Jericho? It's God. God knocks the walls down. Third, another lesson that he learned is that God is always present. I read it already, but three times Joshua is told, and let me read to you one of those times, Joshua 1:5. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with thee. That's it. And two other times in Deuteronomy and one in Numbers, Joshua is reminded of this. Be strong and of good courage. It's God that's with you. Don't worry about the rest. God is with you. Great point. Jesus, when he was going back to heaven, he said the same thing. Great commission. I'm going to not leave you comfortless. I'm going to have the Holy Spirit with you. And that power of God is going to be with you in the presence of God. So God is always present. Fourth. Okay, this one's not particularly from one incident. This is actually more of a big picture that I think Joshua learned from many, many, many incidents. Sin is terrible among the people. Sin brings awful, awful results. I didn't add up how many people Joshua watched. This is bad English. How many people did Joshua see actually die? Tens of thousands. Because of sin. He watched the people, just think of a few of these. When the fire, the fire of the Lord burnt among the people. When the snakes came in among the people and bit people. Joshua saw that. After the golden calf, Joshua watched, I forget how many thousands of people die. Besides all of the adults who died, and Joshua would have seen death constantly. I've never literally watched anybody die. I would imagine it's a kind of dramatic experience. But Joshua saw this regularly. And every time, can you imagine, every time it happens? How terrible, sin. If we could get a picture of how awful sin is, I think it would change how flippant we are towards it. Obviously, it would. So sin is awful. Sin is terrible among the people of God. Another lesson I think he learned, and he would have gotten this from Moses, that a man of God must stand and trust God. A man of God must stand, sometimes, literally, by yourself. Moses. Boy, he watched Moses. Here's all the people down at the bottom of the mountain having a party. And here comes Moses. He wasn't afraid of the protesters. He wasn't afraid of the children of Israel. Here's a whole slew of adults out here acting the fools. And Moses walks in the middle of it, throws down those plates, and mad as can be, and breaks down their thing and makes them drink it. Okay, a man of God has to stand by himself sometimes. And I think that's why, part of it, why Joshua and Caleb then did the same thing. When the time came to stand against them, and that time the people literally wanted to kill him and Moses, wanted to stone him. And Joshua and Caleb stand by themselves. A man of God must stand and trust God. There's going to be some very unpopular things you'll have to do someday, I guarantee you. And you've probably already experienced some of that. I was talking to a bus mom on Saturday. Her dad is the grandpa that lives downstairs from the Reinhardts. Oh, yeah, you would know. Her name is Daniela. But anyway, and she's not saved. as far as I can tell. And we talked. I said, you know, the Lord really changed your dad's life, didn't he? She said, yeah, I guess so. You know, he's not like he used to be. You know, he used to come over and have so much fun together and things, and he just is very much kind of standoffish now. And she said, we had him over at Christmas time. We were all sitting around eating and stuff, having a good time. And he said, I got to go. He said, Dad, why do you have to go? And he said, you know, well, y'all are sitting around here drinking and everything. I can't be here. She said, and so obviously, you know, I agree with, that's God. God did that. Took an old drunk and changed his life. And they're not happy about it because he makes them feel bad now. And she said something about, that she grew up Catholic. She just knew. And I just explained. I said, look, it's not about Baptists against Catholic. It's not about religion versus religion. It's that he found God, and he believes the Bible ought to be taken seriously. And so he's trying to follow the Bible. And I said, you know he loves you. You know. Anyway, so I tried to help her understand that. But the bottom line is, God changed his life. And so, anyway, I think it's wonderful when somebody gets a taste of what God can do in their life and they just stand on that. They believe God and they trust God. That's a wonderful thing. Sometimes in the face of family. Number six, another lesson. Another lesson. Even in judgment, God keeps his promises. Even in judgment, God keeps his promises. All right, here's a reference I'm thinking of to when the children of Israel were punished. God killed all the adults and had all of them die off. He remembered his promise to Joshua and Caleb. Think about this. God doesn't get so caught up in working out his big picture that he forgets his promise to one or two people. You've done that before, right? I've done it before. You're on the bus route, and you've got 45 kids on there, or 30 kids, or whatever, and you tell one kid, if you're good today, I'm going to give you one of the quiet seat prizes. And you get caught up, and you're doing your thing, and you're dropping the kids off, and as the kid walks off the door, he says, you said you were going to give me a quiet seat prize. I forgot. You know, there's nothing left. And now you got to take him to McDonald's and get him something. we forget things. But God never forgets his promise. And living proof of that is that Joshua and Caleb were still alive. Everybody else is dead. Joshua and Caleb live for probably 15, 20 more years after they enter in the land of Canaan at least. So. All right, so even in judgment, God keeps his promise. Another lesson. True spiritual leadership comes from God. Joshua is a leader not because of Moses. Moses certainly was important in Joshua's life, but not because of Moses. Joshua is the leader not because of Joshua. He's not a self-made leader. You know, he took a bunch of seminars on how to become a leader. You know who made Joshua a leader? It was God. You know who made Joshua, and I don't just mean, the position of the leader. Who made Joshua as a man? Who made him a leader? It was God. God can do the same thing with any one of us. Absolutely anybody. Shyest, the most shy person in the world. God can take that person and make them a leader of their family, a leader of other people, a leader of a class, whatever it might be. God can change a person. So the leadership comes from God. True spiritual leadership comes from God. And lastly, this is a very important lesson I think he learned. No man, no man is indispensable. What's the point? What's this in reference to? Joshua watches his mentor make a mistake. Well, that's to put it nicely, right? He sinned He watches Moses go against God one time, but it was pretty, very significant. And he watches God say, Moses, you're not going in. And Joshua, I'm sure, you know, he sees Moses every day, face to face, up close. Joshua knew that this just broke Moses' heart. But sin is sin, and the results of sin are still the result, is still going, the punishment is there. And God said, you're not going in. And Joshua realized even Moses was not in this. Yes, I'm thinking if I said it the right way. Even Moses is indispensable. Is not indispensable. Shoot, I'm getting my negatives mixed up. Even Moses. God doesn't need any of us to get his work done. He can raise somebody else. No man is indispensable. And so he said, I better be true. And as far as we know, other than him not finding a successor, it sure seems to indicate that Joshua was faithful all through his life. Last thing we read of Joshua is in the end of the book of Joshua, before he died, but that he was faithful. Choose you this day, Joshua chapter 24 says. But as for me and my house, that's Joshua. As an older man, after they divided up the land of Canaan and conquered a big part of it, Joshua was faithful. And I think that's part of why that he realized, I better be faithful or God's going to put me on the shelf. Okay, so Joshua's preparation and some lessons that he learned in that preparation. That's where we'll drop today.